My topic starts from a place at which Sabine also began. Every religious tradition begins with revelation that yields at some point to interpretation. All religious traditions offer a dynamic tension between conserving the revelation and rethinking and reshaping its meaning toward contemporary relevance as they move across time and space. While traditions typically interpret through words and the elaboration of theory, they ultimately need to translate words into actions in order to improve the condition of the human community in accordance with the vision of world perfectibility inspired by the original revelation. In one sense, one might suppose that shifting toward the view of divinity as singular, all-powerful, all-knowing, all-good, and interested and involved in human affairs, as those parts of humanity did that came to embrace traditions such as Judaism, Christianity, Islam, that shift out of a polytheistic perspective might at least allow the question of a moral code to be simplified, one source rather than diverse, contending and often mutually contradictory ones, should have solved the problem of ethics. Think of which god or gods you do or don't follow when you are a Greek in the days of Odysseus or in the days of Socrates, by contrast. However, among the varied issues that Abrahamic monotheism raises, the most fundamental is that of interpretation. If we have God's word in principle, as opposed to the words of diverse gods and goddesses, regarding divine expectations and intentions vis-a-vis humanity, we still may not agree in the first place as to exactly what words constitute that word. Thus, the schism within the Israelite Judean community that led to Judaism and Christianity began textually with regard to the question of what constitutes Bible, even before arriving at disagreements regarding particular words or phrases within the text acknowledged by both traditions. Later, Christianity experienced further textual splits. Books considered biblical by Catholic and Orthodox are rejected as such by Protestants, and some embraced by the Ethiopian church are found in no other denomination. Islam arrived on the stage of history in the 7th century and views the Quran to be the definitive revealed text, supplanting all versions of the Jewish and Christian Bibles. It adds a body of hadith that sometimes functions as an elaboration of passages in the Quran. For example, the hadith that fill out the laconic account of Muhammad's Isra to the farthest masjid in Quran chapter 17, verse 1. Not all of which hadiths are, for various reasons beyond what we have time to discuss here, are embraced by all Muslims. All three Abrahamic traditions came to offer large and diverse literatures of interpretation, rabbinic, patristic, scholastic literatures on the one hand, and on the other, diverse schools of Sunni and Shi'i interpretation, or jurisprudence rather, that shape nuantially diverse modes of Sharia, to say nothing of contending with Tazalit and Asharit theological perspectives. Fractionalization, based on diverse interpretational perspectives, is a defining attribute of the religious traditions that address a single, all-encompassing God to the present day. On the other hand, given a common source, capital S, for the universe and ourselves, that is understood by all of these traditions to be all good, all merciful, and interested in us, and not just all powerful and all knowing, then addressing ourselves to and through that source should offer the possibility of functioning in an array of modes of partnership with God toward furthering the moral perfection of the world. The obligation toward such partnership is not surprisingly based on interpreting revealed texts. So in Genesis 1:28, for example, shared by Jews and Christians, we are enjoined to be fruitful and multiply, fill the earth and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea, the birds of the air, and over every living thing that creeps upon the earth. The obvious question raised by God's words is, what are the terms subdue and dominion? Translation of Hebrew words kavash and radach actually mean subjection and dominion. Through a careful read of the textual context surrounding the verse, may be understood as terms that don't merely empower us to assert our will over the world around us, but as imperatives to use our power to shepherd the world, engaging in constant efforts to improve and even to help to perfect it in partnership with the God who, by ceding to us free will, has invited that partnership, and that partnership includes all humans. Similarly, in Quran 2:29, we are referred to as vice-regents, created by God. The Arabic term rendered as vice-regent is khalifa. One might ask, or one might see this rather as a gloss on the Genesis narrative, The Quran makes more explicit than in Genesis the position of humankind between God and other creatures, of acting on God's behalf toward them. For what does a vice-regent, a deputy, a caliph, do? He serves in place of the regent when the latter is not available, seeks to carry out what the regent's actions would be were he present, and must answer to the regent for whatever those actions are, resulting either in approval or disapproval for them. In our own time, there are diverse movements and organizations that, looking back at one or both of these scriptural passages and others, have shaped themselves as entities whose reason for existence is to transmute these logoi, these words, into erga, actions of improving the world. Among these entities, the Christian faith-based and driven International Center for Religious Diplomacy, in its 13-year, almost 14-year history, has been engaged in helping, and I'm quoting from their own website, to prevent and resolve identity-based conflicts that exceed the reach of traditional diplomacy by incorporating religion as part of the solution, end of quote. Connecting religious reconciliation with official and unofficial diplomacy to shape an innovative peacemaking synergy. A second such entity is the Hizmet Movement, which Sabina mentioned at the beginning of her discussion, that inspired for over 30 years by the teachings of the student Gülen, has been engaged in diverse educational and social activities rooted in a Sufi-based altruism that sees serving God as most effectively enacted by serving others. The Hizmet Movement's underlying ideology is Muslim, and specifically Sufi. By way of Gülen's inspiration, the movement is guided by a universalist sensibility that may be recognized in particular in the writings of the legalist and Sufi Ibn Arabi of the 12th, 13th century, and the Sufi poet Jalaluddin Rumi of the 13th century. There are passages in the writings of both thinkers that are remarkable in the universalism that they express in any era, but particularly in the era in which they lived, in which religious wars were so widespread, within the Muslim and Christian worlds, and in particular between those worlds. Just think of the Crusades and the Reconquista at opposite ends of the Mediterranean during that era. So, for example, Ibn Arabi wrote, "My heart can take on any form. My creed is love. Wherever its caravan turns along the way, that is my belief, my faith," among other passages. And Rumi wrote, among other words, "I go into the Muslim mosque and the Jewish synagogue and the Christian church, and I see one altar." Gülen's thought is in many ways inspired by this sort of thinking. His own writings make it very clear that he perceives no contradiction between being an emphatically spiritually aware Muslim, as Ibn Arabi and Rumi certainly were, and someone who embraces all forms of faith. For he, like they, recognizes the fundamental truth of the mystical process, that one must empty oneself of one's own ego if one is to be filled with God, means that clinging to the idea that one's own particular form of faith is the only legitimate form of faith is a mode of clinging to one's own ego rather than to God. In recognizing that freedom from ego means that the mystic's goal is not ultimately to achieve enlightenment, for that is selfish, but to gain enlightenment so that one may benefit the community around one, Gülen writes and teaches insistently that one must transform words and theories into a broad spectrum of actions. His articulation of the concept of hizmet, the Turkish word for service, is based on his spiritual commitment and his mystical commitment, a synthesis of logos and mythos, but it directs itself consistently toward ergon, action. The Hizmet Movement is like the thought of Ibn Arabi, Rumi, and Gülen, built on a Muslim foundation, but it promotes a universalist agenda in the work that it accomplishes. One may see this most obviously in the now 1,500, or I've now heard more than 2,000, so you count them, I can, schools, from elementary to university levels, in many countries and continents, including, of course, the United States and Canada, here in North America. Informed by its ideals, these schools have as a primary purpose to create generations of young people who are devoted to altruistic service. They're run by administrators and teachers who are themselves models of Hizmet. They're available to their students well beyond the times of their formal teaching hours. And they offer to their students of diverse ethnic, religious, and racial backgrounds a range of subjects from humanities to sciences to the arts to sports, with no emphasis on Islam, either overtly or covertly. Their goal is to teach their students most effectively to be full human beings in both the Socratic Platonic sense, asking questions, cross-examining answers, engaging in dialogues within their own minds and with each other. And in the three-dimensional sense of recognizing the value of, and thus including in the curriculum, hard sciences and social sciences, humanities and fine arts, mental education and physical education. Their goal is to train individuals to be concerned about the world around them and not only about themselves. Individuals who are not only ready but eager to assist in the ongoing process of perfecting the world. Gülen has often written how important this is. He notes that, and I'm quoting, altruism is an exalted human feeling and its course is love. And he comments his another quote, the true human progress and evolution in relation to our essential being is only possible with education. Thus, he writes, the school must be as perfect as possible with respect to curriculum, its teachers' scientific and moral standards, and its physical conditions. For ultimately, a school is a place of learning about everything related to this life and the next. In essence, a school is a kind of place of worship whose holy people are teachers. Nor is this perspective limited by the Hizmet movement to formal educational processes. On the contrary, the shaping of diverse Rumi forward dialogue institutes, Gülen institutes with their arrays of programs, ranging from friendship dinners to study tours to lectures and discussions, are part of an outreach effort that promotes interfaith, interethnic, and multicultural understanding in a proactive, logos become ergon process, the point and purpose of which is to improve the improvement of the world in which we all live and in which we want our children and their children to live. Hizmet is driven by a basic Rumiian notion that is at the heart of Gülen's teaching. Come to the door of love and join us and sit with us. Come, let us speak one to another through our hearts. Let us speak secretly without ears and eyes. Let us laugh together without lips or sound. Let us laugh like the roses. Like thought, let us see each other without any words or sounds. Since all are the same, let us call each other from our hearts. We won't use our lips or tongue. As our hands are clasped together, let us talk about it. The goal of the International Center for Religious Diplomacy is arguably the same, talking about it, and thereby making the world a better place. But its method and the forum in which it operates are different. The foundation of the Hizmet movement is education, and while its leadership is specifically informed by Islam, largely Turkish Sunni Sufi Islam, yet its programs are not overtly directed toward religion at all, much less toward Islam specifically. The ICRD is driven by Christian ethos, but without Christianity per se as a focus. Its mission is to intervene in different parts of the world in order to resolve, or better still, to prevent conflicts between groups that are identity-based, and seeks to do so by incorporating religion into the process of seeking solutions, a process that carries beyond where standard issue diplomacy manages to reach. Any number of conflicts across the world are not easily susceptible to government-to-government resolutions because their bases are ethnic, religious, tribal, and the available forms of governmental interventions fall short. The leadership of the ICRD involves itself when possible by specifically diminishing the role of religion as a force driving a given conflict, and paradoxically, by augmenting the role of clergy and lay religious leaders and their capacity to be involved in the process of resolving conflicts. This is in part made possible by increasing the level of awareness of policymakers and their receptivity to potential contributions that can be made to the peacemaking process by such leaders. The underlying idea is that in linking religious reconciliation with other sorts of official and unofficial diplomacy, more conflicts can be resolved and fewer begin in the first place. A recent instance where this sort of ideal has been enacted as a practical ergon action level is that in July 2013, just a few months ago, ICRD conducted two faith-based reconciliation workshops in Midyat, Turkey, for Kurdish, Syriac, Christian, and Muslim Arab tribal leaders, all from the Al-Hasakah region of eastern Syria. The goal of the workshop was to shape a social contract specifically between the Kurds and the Syriac Christians that will commit them to live peacefully side by side regardless of the outcome of the horrific Syrian civil war. And the second workshop facilitated a problem-solving session on political power sharing and regional security with the leaders of all three of these groups. the contract in its final stages of details and distribution has apparently been enthusiastically received with all three groups and offers a foundation upon which potentially to build on a larger national scale, who knows, as the Syrian debacle moves forward toward an uncertain conclusion. I point on her because she brought up Syria this morning. That's why I was looking that way. By appropriate coincidence, at around the same time that this double workshop was pushing forward successfully, the U.S. Department established a new Office of Religious Engagement, and the announcement of this new office came with prominent reference to ICRD, suggesting that the idea of including religious issues within our political calculus is an expanding idea, an idea whose time has come, or perhaps returned, after an absence of several centuries. The challenge, of course, will be to see to it that religion doesn't simply resurface as an instrument, a weapon of politics, and that the politicians and policymakers affected by the theory behind the new State Department office gain from it a nuanced sense of these issues. Most of the history of the world has seen religion and politics interweave each other more often than not with a negative outcome, whether in the centuries-long struggle between church and state, or in the assertion of political leaders from the pharaohs to 18th century European kings that they ruled through divine imprimatur. The purpose defined by ICRD is to restore religion to a place within the political world that informs its diplomacy in an innovative, socially helpful manner, beginning with theory, exploring the positive role that religious or spiritual factors can play in preventing or resolving conflict, and helping to advance social change based on justice and reconciliation. The ICRD acts, and in so doing, offers a powerful case for incorporating religious considerations into the practice of international politics and a blueprint for how to do so. Thought yields action as its leaders serve in the world. The Hizmet Movement and the International Center for Religious Diplomacy differ from each other in their details. What they share in common is the conviction that the world can be most successfully pushed forward through understanding our own and each other's faiths, sharing that understanding and using it to act and innovate, that is, shaping our sense of revelation toward Ergon, toward actions that improve the world. Thank you.